the time. Can we take down a little height from the mic? It's a little too high. 1, 2, 1, 2, amen. I would like to thank the Cornerstone Community Choir for blessing our hearts with that special item of music. We want to thank God for the ministry of Pastor Vassal, who has been, I know, a blessing to this church. Amen.
Amen.
Let's continue to pray for our leaders. Let's continue to pray for our brothers and sisters. As human beings, we tend to have a disposition to engage in negative conversation, in conversations that negatively criticize each other. But I want to give us a challenge as we enter into this second quarter of 2017. I want to give us a challenge. Every time we are tempted to speak an idle word, every time we are tempted to speak of an individual in a negative light, let us rebuke that temptation in the name of Jesus. And let us allow God to use the tongues that He has blessed us with, the ability of speech that He has blessed us with, to build up the body of believers. Amen. One of the things that we do that I find it is very unfortunate is that at funerals we tend to say so many positive things about the deceased who is laying before us. And many times I wonder whether the deceased in his or her life had the opportunity to hear all those wonderful things we are saying about them. I suspect that many of us have a strange respect for death. Many of us seem to have more respect for the dead than for the living. And so at an individual's funeral, we would shower them with words of affirmation, whereas in their lifetime, we would shower them with words of criticism. So that's why I say I suspect that many of us have more respect for the dead than for the living. As a pastor, I have conducted many funerals and many weddings, and I have never been to a funeral that started late. But I have been to countless weddings where I have been sitting down there for 1 hour, 2 hours. The longest I waited for the bride to come was 4 hours. Many of us seem to have more regards for the dead than for the living. And so I want to encourage us to take time to affirm each other while we have each other around. I want to, for the next few moments, to turn our attentions to the book of Revelation. And as I mentioned last time I was here, we will be reflecting on that book this year. And so on Wednesday evening, we had the opportunity to go through the message to the second church, the message to the church of Smyrna in Revelation chapter 2. And the last Sabbath I was here, earlier in the year, we looked at the message to the first church, the message to the church at Ephesus. And I want to remind us as we get ready to reflect on this third message to the church at Pergamos, that the book of Revelation is both a timely and a timeless book. Timely in that it was written in AD 95, to be exact, written by John, the beloved apostle. That was towards the close of the first century. And so as John wrote to the churches in Asia Minor, those seven churches in Asia Minor, which is modern-day Turkey in that particular region, as he wrote to those churches, he was writing to them and addressing circumstances and situations which they were all going through at that time. But even as John was writing towards the close of the first century, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, every single thing that he was writing would have eternal relevance to coming generations. And so we are in the 21st century, and we find that the admonition to this third church listed in Revelation chapter 2 is relevant to every single one of us. And so I'd like to invite you to please stand with me as we read, take time to read this message to the church in Pergamos in Revelation chapter 2, and we will read from verse 12 to verse 17. Revelation chapter 2, verses 12 to 17. The Bible says, "And to the angel in the church of the church in Pergamos write, these things saith he which hath the sharp sword with two edges, I know thy works, and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you, where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against you, because you have there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou also them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saveth he that receiveth it." I want to read again verse number 17. Verse 17, "He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saving he that receiveth it." I want to speak to us for the next few moments on the subject, the transforming power of God's Word. The transforming power of God's Word. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear God, for your Word. We thank you for this opportunity that we have to open up your Word. As we have opened up your Word, dear Father, we pray that you may open our eyes so that we might behold wonderful things from your Word. Distract us, dear Father, from that which takes your place in our lives. Distract us, dear God, from that which causes worry and perplexity, and cause us to turn our eyes upon Jesus. And as we gaze into the wonderful and beautiful face of Jesus, may we behold the glory of Christ. And by beholding Christ's glory today, may every single one of us be changed and be transformed to reflect his glory, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Please be seated. the transforming power of God's Word. As I have been saying, every single message to every single church in Revelation 2 and Revelation 3 begins with a portrait of Jesus. This is very significant because before John the Revelator began to write the messages to the seven churches, John the Revelator was informed that the book of Revelation is a revelation of Jesus Christ. That means from Revelation 1 all the way to the end, Revelation 22 is all about Jesus. And John makes it plain in Revelation chapter 1 verse 1 that the message was given to him by God, and the message was sent and it was also signified. The message was not just sent, but it was signified in addition to being sent. The message was signified in that the message was codified. The message was placed into symbolic form. You see, John the Revelator was on the Isle of Patmos. He was imprisoned for preaching the Word of God. He was on the Isle of Patmos in the first century, that little island to the west of Asia Minor, across the Aegean Sea. He was incarcerated there for preaching the Word of God. Now you can imagine, after having been incarcerated for preaching the Word of God, you can imagine the problems you would probably get yourself in if you continue to use the same method you were using that got you in trouble in the first place. Are you with me? The truth of the matter is that preaching the Word of God will at times bring persecution. When persecution comes, however, we need to be very careful to respond to persecution in the context of the Holy Spirit. Sadly, many Christians will shorten their lifespans because they refuse to allow the Holy Spirit to inspire them with wisdom and discernment to adjust their methods in proclaiming the gospel. And so you can imagine John being incarcerated for proclaiming the gospel, and you can imagine John standing up in Patmos and writing clear, plain letters to the churches preaching that same gospel. You can imagine that that most likely would have shortened the lifespan of John. And so the Holy Spirit inspired John with wisdom to codify that message, to put that message in symbolic form, for the Holy Spirit knew that in order for any letter to leave Patmos, to go across the Aegean Sea, over to the various communities in Asia Minor, the Holy Spirit knew that the prison guards would first inspect those letters, and if those letters contained any messages that were suspect in nature, if those letters contained any messages that diverted the attention of the citizens from emperor worship to the worship of the true God Yahweh, if those letters contained any of those subjects, those letters would be blocked. And so the message was sent, but it was also codified, it was also put into symbolic form in order to preserve the message. But rest assured, once the message got to the various churches, once the message got to its intended destination, guess who meant the message there? The same Holy Spirit who signified the message, met the messages as they landed in Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamos and Thyatira and Sardis and Philadelphia. As the messages entered into Laodicea, the Holy Spirit met the messages, and the Holy Spirit was the one who interpreted the messages to the believers.
And so as the believers opened the messages, the first thing, the first reality that they encountered was Jesus.
Hallelujah.
As they opened the message, the first person they encountered was Jesus. You can check it out in every single message. In this particular message, Jesus reveals himself in the introduction to the message as being the one who has a sharp sword with two edges. And it's interesting to note that whatever way Jesus revealed himself in the introduction of those various messages, it was a revelation of Christ that was relevant to what the people were going through. And so Jesus Christ is revealed in Revelation 2, verse 17, as the one who has a sharp sword with two edges. And the condition of the church is a condition of spiritual declension. That is, it's a condition where, yes, in the church, there are individuals, according to Revelation 2, verse 13, who are faithful, who have not denied the name of God. There are individuals in the church like Brother Antipas, who actually was willing to die for the faith, and he did die for the faith. He refused to recant his faith in Jesus Christ. There were individuals in the church who refused to worship the emperor, which was very common in the first, second century. It was very common. As a matter of fact, every single citizen of Asia Minor, every single citizen within that Roman province over which Rome had jurisdiction, had to worship the emperor. Now, you couldn't just say that you worship the emperor and get a free pass. You had to prove that you worshipped the emperor. How will you prove that you worshipped the emperor? Well, first of all, the Roman government made provisions for individuals, the citizens of Rome, even the church members, to go up to the high places to burn incense in honor of the emperor. And once the incense was burnt in worship to the emperor, who was considered to be God, the individuals were given certificates to hold in safekeeping. So as the Roman officials went to the community to ascertain who was obedient to emperor worship and who was not, they would ask to show the certificates. And if the individuals could not produce the certificate, they would be sentenced to death. That's how Antipas in Revelation 2 verse 13 lost his life. When the Roman emperors went to his home and they asked to show the certificate, he had no certificate to show because he refused to worship the emperor. And so they captured Antipas, and the crime that they laid against him was the crime of atheism. And that's rather curious that they would capture a man of God, a worshiper of Jehovah, and they would accuse him of atheism, and they would be so successful in the accusation that they would even kill him, execute him. He was considered to be an atheist because, remember, the Roman emperor declared himself to be God, and whoever did not acknowledge the Roman emperor as being God was considered to be an atheist. Not only did you have to have a certificate to prove that you worship the emperor, but also you had to have in your possession foods that were dedicated to the pagan gods. Foods that were offered up to the pagan gods. And by you having those foods in your possession and consuming those foods, you will be aligning yourself with pagan worship. And so I mentioned that the main issue for the church at Pergamos was that there was spiritual decline. declension. And it's rather interesting that Jesus Christ would reveal himself to them as the one who has a sharp sword with two edges. And my question today is, what relevance does the sharp sword with two edges have to do with spiritual declension? What relevance? Well, we need to ask ourselves the question, what is a sharp sword with two edges? Well, if you turn with me in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, we will discover it. Just turn a few books backwards, and you will find Hebrews. So you go from Revelation, you find Jude, then you go 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, then you find 1st and 2nd Peter, which we are studying for our lesson this quarter. Then you will find James, and if you go a little further back, you'll find the book of Hebrews. And once you come to Hebrews, I want you to look at chapter 12, Hebrews rather chapter 4, and we want to look at verse 12. And we want to ascertain, what is the sharp sword with two edges? And so in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, the Bible declares, for the word of God is quick and what? And powerful. And it is sharper than any what? Two-edged sword. So the two-edged sword is what? The word of God. It's referred to as a two-edged sword because it pierces even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So the main problem with the church in Pergamos is one of spiritual declension. And Jesus Christ introduces himself as the one who has what in his mouth? The word in his mouth. The truth of the matter is, the only reason why the brethren in Pergamos were experiencing spiritual declension was because they were neglecting the word of God. So Jesus Christ comes to them with the very solution for their condition of spiritual declension, which is the word of God. I want us to take time to observe the nature of this spiritual declension, for it is very specific in Scripture what that is. In Revelation chapter 2, verse 14, we are told that there are individuals in the church who hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now, we are free to assume what that doctrine is. You can go on YouTube and you can go on Google and hear all sorts of individuals have all sorts of fancy things to say about what that doctrine is. But the truth of the matter is, the Bible itself tells us what the doctrine is. Are you with me? The doctrine of Balaam is revealed to us clearly in the Bible. And so I want you, if you would, just quickly turn with me to the book of Numbers. The book of Numbers. And we're going to encounter this individual called Balaam, after whom this terrible doctrine is named. A doctrine which characterized the spiritual declension of the church. And you know, Balaam is a very interesting story. Well, let me give you some background to the story, because we will not look at the entire story, for the story goes from Numbers 22 all the way to Numbers 25, and we won't look at the entire story. As a matter of fact, it doesn't stop in Numbers 25, it goes all the way to Numbers 31, where we see Balaam being killed. Are you with me? But the main story is from Numbers 22 to Numbers 25, and the background to the story is that Moses is on his last leg. Are you with me? For you recall that God told Moses that he would not be permitted to enter into the promised land. So it was Moses' responsibility to bring the Israelites to the brink of the promised land, on the brink of the River Jordan, while he prepared Joshua to take over. Now the Israelites are on the brink of possessing the promised land. Just like many of us today are on the brink of the New Jerusalem, are on the brink of glory, eternal glory. They were on the brink of possessing the promised land. And then they were just camped outside of Moab. They did not threaten Moab. They did not tell Moab, we are about to possess your land. But Moab heard about the Israelites. Moab heard about how the Israelites dominated the Ammonites and took over their land and dispossessed them totally. And Moab became afraid. So Moab had enough sense to know that as powerful as his army was, as strong as his men were, he had enough sense to know that they could not fight against the people of God, because the people of God had the power of God on their side. And I wish that many of us as Christians would just spend some more time focusing on the God that we serve. Spend some more time glorifying and magnifying Him, instead of allowing the various peripheral things of life to frustrate us and to sabotage us. Moab, the heathen king, knew how powerful God was, and so he decided that the only way we could actually overcome these people is if I get somebody to curse them, to put a spiritual curse upon them. So there was a man by the name of Balaam. Balaam was a man who would go around putting curses on people, and strangely enough, those curses would come to pass. And so if Balaam looked at you and he didn't like you, and he put a curse on you that all your hair should just drop from your head, you'd wake up the following morning and you would see all your hair on the pillow. All of Balaam's curses would come to pass. Now, something interesting about Balaam is that Balaam had a knowledge of Jehovah. As a matter of fact, Balaam considered himself to be a man of God. But yet still, Balaam would walk around cursing people. Have you ever come across some Christians who curse people? People who say that they are followers of God, but yet still they engage in practices that are totally opposite to what Jesus Christ stands for. And so Balaam called upon Balaam, and you know the story very well. Balaam knew, according to the law in Deuteronomy, that first of all, he should not be practicing divination, number one. And he knew, number two, that who God blesses, no man can curse. But Balaam was sort of distracted. He was a man of God. He considered himself to be a man of God. But when Balak, the king of the Moabites, sent to call Balaam, Balak did not send his messengers empty-handed. He sent gifts with them. He sent promises of great honor to Balaam. In other words, if you curse these people, guess what, Balaam? I will pay your mortgage. I will wipe out your car loan. If you curse them, I will take care of your children's student loans. If you curse them, Balaam, you will never have to wonder or worry about where your next meal is going to come from, because Balaam, you'll have enough money to buy all of the supermarkets and restaurants in all of Moab if you just curse these people for me. So moving on quickly, Balaam, the man of God, for the purpose of economic expediency, chooses to compromise the principles that he knows to be right. And Balaam now goes on this journey to curse God. Of course he prayed to God about it, like a faithful Christian would. And when he prayed to God about it, God obviously, through the Holy Spirit, revealed to Balaam that that's not within the context of his will. But Balaam was so persistent that something strange happened. Something strange happened. In Numbers chapter 22, verse 20, it seems as if God actually gives Balaam permission, the green light, or his blessings to go and curse God's own people. Just let me just say something right here and there. Anytime there is a plain command in the Word of God, anytime there is something you know you should not do, or there's something you know you should do, and you allow yourself to be presumptuous enough to go and present to God in prayer what you know you should not do, eventually, guess what God is going to do? God is going to give you His blessings. Now, what do I mean by that? God is an interesting person, you know. God at times gives you His blessings to disobey His word. Can I get a witness? How many of you have ever, as Christians, done things that you know you shouldn't do? And while you are doing those things that you know you shouldn't do, God is still blessing you. God is still preserving you. God is still protecting you. You don't have to answer. Because the fact that every single one of you are here today is testimony to the reality. Because every single one of us in here today have in the past found ourselves engaging in things that we are convinced, based on the word of God, we should not do, yet we do those things. And God doesn't strike us down dead. God doesn't stop the food from coming into our homes. God still blesses us. Church, I've come to realize, you know, we say certain things in church that don't actually make sense. One of the things we say is that you can run away from God. And I'm sure all of us have said it before, I've said it before. But my question to you is, how can you say an individual can run away from God on one hand, and on the other hand say that God is omnipresent? Talk to me, somebody. For God to be omnipresent means that God is where? God is everywhere. So if God is everywhere, how on earth can I run away from God? Lord have mercy. Jonah should remind us that because of God's omnipresence, running away from God, and guess who he met in the ocean? He met God. Balaam can testify that he got on his ass and he began to ride away from God. And guess who he encountered? So Balaam is on the donkey. And let's read from verse 22 of Numbers 22. The Bible says, and God's anger was kindled because Balaam went, and the angel of the Lord stood in the way for an adversary against him. So he was running away from the will of God. But guess where the will of God found him? Guess where the presence of God found him? Right in front of him on his path to disobedience. Now, Numbers 22, verse 22, the last part. Now he was riding upon his ass, and his two servants were with him, And the ass saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand. And the ass turned aside out of the way and went into the field. And Balaam smote the ass to turn her into the way. So get this. Let me just try to demonstrate this. Balaam is on. I'm going to use donkey, right? Because we know the age where ass is a bad word. So I'm going to use donkey for those individuals who are disturbed when they hear the word ass. So Balaam is on his donkey. He's riding his donkey to go and curse the people of God. And God sends his angel to stand in the way of the donkey. And so the donkey sees the presence of God, but Balaam doesn't see it. And so the donkey turns around and goes to the field. Now, Balaam knows this donkey. This donkey has never done anything in its life outside of Balaam's command. So Balaam gets frustrated. Balaam is not just frustrated that the donkey turned left to go into the field, but Balaam is frustrated because that foolish donkey is getting in the way of his mission for economic expediency. Because the king has promised him a great reward. And so as Balaam is riding, all he is seeing is the material gain. So Balaam begins to beat the donkey. Then the donkey reluctantly turns back on the road. Guess what the donkey sees again? The donkey sees the presence of God. But Balaam didn't see it. So they are in between two walls that makes the road very narrow. And the donkey squeezes to the right and crushes Balaam's right leg against the wall. Balaam said, no. I don't know what this donkey drank, but I'm going to knock some sense into this donkey's head. Balaam began to beat the donkey. Say, hey, you stupid donkey. If I could have walked, I'd have walked, but I need you. I need to get to the king to curse those people. Stop your foolishness. And you know how some parents do. Well, nobody here, hopefully. But I know some people in other countries where as they are talking, they are beating their children. So it's like they are quarreling with their children and beating them at the same time. That's what Balaam was doing. He was beating the donkey while cursing the donkey. Finally, he got the donkey back up and they're going. And guess what the donkey sees again? The donkey sees the presence of God three times. And the donkey says, listen, that's it. Donkey just fell down. Flat on the ground. Now here is where the story gets really interesting. Numbers 22 verse 28. And the Lord opened the mouth of the ass, and she said unto Balaam, what have I done unto thee that thou hast smitten me these three times? Now that's one thing, right? That's one thing. That doesn't really surprise me. The fact that an ass is speaking does not surprise me. What surprises me is verse 29. And Balaam said unto the ass. Church, listen. If I have a cat or a dog in my house, and one day I hear that cat or that dog starting to talk to me, do you think I'm answering the cat? Listen, I'm out of that house, and I'm going to find Pastor Vassal, Pastor Wright, Pastor Horrell to cover the olive oil. The amazing thing is not that the ass spoke to Balaam, but that Balaam is responding to the ass. And he's acting as if this is That's what sin does to us. Sin pushes us into a place where we begin to operate in an alternate reality. I want to borrow some words from Kelly and Conway. We want to operate in alternative facts. That's what sin does to us. It moves us into a dimension of alternative facts where we begin to function in that dimension. So, Balaam in Numbers 22:29 speaks to the ass. Because you mock me, I would bear a sword in my hand, for now I will kill you. And the ass said unto Balaam, am I not thine ass, upon which thou hast ridden ever since I was thine unto this day? Was I ever wont to do so unto thee? And he said, nay. Like they're talking as if there's some kind of, you know, two human beings talking to each other. Verse 21, then the Lord opened the eyes of Balaam, and he saw the angel of the Lord standing in the way, and his sword drawn in his hand, and he bowed down his head and fell flat on his face. And the angel of the Lord said unto him, wherefore hast thou smitten thine ass these three times? Behold, I went out to withstand thee, because thy way is perverse before me. And the ass saw me and turned from me these three times. Unless she had turned from me, surely now also I had slain thee and saved her alive. So God is saying, Balaam, the only reason you are alive right now is because of the ass. Now, this story to me doesn't seem, yes, it's a rather strange story with an ass talking to a man talking back to an ass. But this doesn't really sound too serious to the point where you can get a doctrine out of it that can lead to the spiritual demise of the church. So what's the doctrine of Balaam? Well, first of all, the story didn't end there. The story goes on into Numbers 23, Numbers 24, Numbers 25, and then Balaam is allowed to go to entertain Balak, to make Balak think that he's going to curse God's people. But God tells him, listen, I'm going to let you go, but you don't curse, you bless. So Balaam goes to Balak, and Balak, you know, is so excited because after all, he's going to get to curse the Israelites and defeat the Israelites. Then Balaam opens his mouth and he begins to bless Israel. Balak said, no, Balaam, you didn't get it. I brought you here to curse them. Let's go to another mountain. Go to another mountain. Balak waits for Balaam to curse Israel. Balaam blesses Israel. Balak says, Balaam, listen, what's your problem? Don't you understand? Whatever you want. At this time, Balak tells Balaam, Balaam, you know what? Maybe what I offered you isn't enough. Here is a blank check, a blank check. You are the one who will be responsible to put whatever figure you want on that check. Just curse God's people. Third time. Balaam blesses them. Balaam leaves frustrated because he is not blessed with the wages of unrighteousness. But where's the doctrine? Balaam goes home, and Balaam gets this bright idea. Maybe if I can't curse Israel, I can get Israel to curse themselves. So Balaam now plans with Balak to have a big festival, a big pagan festival, where they bring out their drinks and their music and their dancing. And Balaam plans with Balak to have some of the most beautiful women at the forefront parading their bodies. And before you knew it, the Israelite men became intoxicated with pleasure, became aroused by these heathen women. The Israelite men began to sleep with those heathen women. The Israelites began to eat food sacrificed to idols, and as a consequence, they imploded. The wrath of God was kindled, and in one day, the wrath of God struck down 24,000 Israeli men. And while God's wrath was striking down these Israelites, while his wrath was striking them down, my friends, there was one Israelite who, in the midst of the judgment of God, came into the camp. His name was Omri, with a Midianite woman, and they were engaging in sexual intercourse. He knows that God is judging Israel for its disobedience, for its fornication. He knows that God is judging Israel for allowing Balaam and Balak to seduce him into immorality. But sin has so mesmerized his mind, he has become blind to the presence of God, just like Balaam became blind to the presence of God. Well, that was the last night he ever touched a woman. But next thing he knew, a spear was piercing through his back, through his belly, into the belly, and into the back of the woman he was on top of. And the plague was stayed. So what is this doctrine of Balaam? Firstly, we see that this doctrine of Balaam is a doctrine that leads to spiritual compromise for the purpose of economic expediency. Are you with me? Doctrine of Balaam. Balaam was long dead, but in the church of Pergamos, there were believers who, in order for them to stay alive, in order for them to not be fired from their jobs, in order for them to make ends meet, in order for them to pay the bills, there were believers in Pergamos who were compromising their spiritual principles. My question is, do we have the doctrine of Balaam in our churches today? Many of us come to this country as immigrants from our various countries of origins, and as we land here, we realize that it's not easy to be poor in this country and to make it, and so we try our best to engage in gainful employments, and we recognize that somehow or the other, people don't seem to have as much respect for the Sabbath as they had in other countries. Are you with me? I'm telling you, my friends, when I worked in St. Lucia, one of the banks was giving one of my members a hard time for working on Sabbath. I went into the bank and gave the manager an ultimatum, and guess what? The woman had her job on Monday. Because it seems as if individuals in some other countries have more regard and have more fear in their hearts for God. But you come here and you realize that people don't really care when you go to church, when you worship. If you want a job, you better make sure you work when we want you to work. And so individuals begin to compromise their spiritual principles for the purposes of economic expediency. Oh, well, God will understand. My friends, the truth of the matter is that if God would understand, God would not warn us against the doctrine of Balaam. And God would not say in Revelation chapter 2, verse 16, that unless you repent, I will come and fight against you with the sword of my mouth. Many of us are arousing the wrath of God because of our disobedience. The doctrine of Balaam is also a doctrine which seeks to on the mutually exclusive powers of good and evil, the doctrine of Balaam. There are Christians who want the best of both worlds. They want to leverage on the promises of God. They want to claim all the promises of God while they are indulging in all the works of the flesh. The doctrine of Balaam seeks to leverage on the mutually exclusive powers of good and evil. That's a mistake that Solomon made, the wisest man who ever lived. In Ecclesiastes 1 verse 17, Solomon admits that I gave my heart to know wisdom, but also to know foolishness and madness. And I discovered that it leads to a vexation of spirit. Solomon tried to dabble in both worlds. The doctrine of Balaam is a doctrine that seeks to sanctify. Listen to me, church. The doctrine of Balaam seeks to sanctify the carnal will rather than submitting to the strict and sanctified will of God. The strict will of God was to refrain from being moved and influenced by Balaam. That was the strict will of God. But Balaam's carnal will was to entertain Balak in order to prosper materially. So Balaam tried to sanctify his carnal will. Church, are you listening to me? So you coming to me and telling me, Pastor, there are laid off individuals in my workplace and I want you to pray for me that I don't lose my job. The same job that you are using to break the law of God. Listen to me, church. You asking for prayers to keep the very job, to protect the very job that you are using to transgress God's word, is you seeking to sanctify your carnal will. Are we together, church?
Yes.
You know, we need to start operating like the ass and not Balaam. Are we together?
Yes.
Because the ass was the one who saw the angel. And the ass, even though the ass this was a special ass, he could have talked. Even though he could have talked, he didn't argue with the angel. He immediately stood fast in the will of God. But Balaam was the one who was trying to maneuver around the will of God. You know, there are some Christians who pray some strange prayers. You engage in all kinds of illicit and immoral and illegal activities, and you have the audacity to ask people to pray for you, to bless you. That's the doctrine of Balaam. You know, it's funny how the explicit or the clear will of God suddenly becomes ambiguous the moment it conflicts with our human desires and inclinations. It's funny. It's funny, Pastor, how the explicit will of God suddenly becomes ambiguous the moment it conflicts with human desires and inclinations. There are some of us, we know what we must do until what we want to do conflicts with what we must do. You know, the Bible isn't complicated, you know. You know why the Bible is complicated to many of us? It's because of our immorality. It's because of our stubbornness. It's because of our propensity to project our will upon God and not allow God to transform our will by His will. The doctrine of Balaam. is a doctrine that leads individuals not only into adultery and fornication and sexual immorality, but is a doctrine that leads Christians. Are you with me? The doctrine of Balaam doesn't relate to heathens or people outside the church. It relates to people within the church. The doctrine of Balaam has to do with individuals allowing their carnal lusts and carnal desires and carnal nature to supersede the powerful influence of the Holy Spirit. And so God is saying to us in Revelation chapter 2 verse 14, what I have against you is that you have people around you who hold the doctrine of Balaam. Now notice in Revelation chapter 2 verse 14, God speaks about thou and them. Are you with me? Thou and them. Thou are those who, according to Revelation 2 verse 13, have not denied the faith of God. Them are those who hold the doctrine of Balaam. Are you with me? So God is saying in Revelation chapter 2 verse 14, I have a few things against you because you have them that hold the doctrine of Balaam. God is not speaking at this point to the individuals who hold the doctrine of Balaam, but he's speaking to the faithful ones. And God is saying to the faithful ones, I have something against you. And what I have against you is that you have them. Church, are you seeing this? You are entertaining, you are tolerating, you are embracing, you are turning a blind eye to them who hold the doctrine of Balaam. This is speaking of our redemptive responsibility. In 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17 to 21, we are told about our redemptive responsibility. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 to 21. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. God has reconciled you unto himself through Jesus. And now that God has reconciled you unto himself through Jesus, guess what? Jesus is now in you, reconciling everybody else unto himself. We have a responsibility to God. Now the problem is not that we don't know. We know. If there's one thing we specialize in, it's in knowing other people's business. So it's not that we don't know. But it's that once we know, we choose to talk to the wrong people. So we know something about somebody, and instead of approaching the person in a spirit, in a humble spirit of love, we approach other individuals and talk to other people about that person. By doing that, we are aligning ourselves with the same spirit that's working in those other individuals, the spirit of Satan. So he's saying, I have a few things against you, Revelation 2 verse 14, because you have there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols, and to commit fornication. This was a reality in the first century church, and it's a reality in the 21st century church. Are we together, church? Fornication. Is fornication a problem in our churches today? Can I talk about fornication for 5 minutes? Today is prayer and fasting. Can I talk about fornication for 5 minutes?
You know, you can be a virgin and still be a fornicator. Are we together, church? You may have never even touched a man or woman in your life, but you are a fornicator. Because you remember what Jesus Christ said in Matthew? In Matthew chapter 5? Let's read quickly. Matthew chapter 5, verse 28. Whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. There are two things there. Do you see them there? There are two things in this text. There is the looking, but there is something else. Whoever looks at a woman to lust after her has committed adultery already with her in his heart. Now, there are some women who think that this text has nothing to do with them. Are you with me? Because the issue is with the men's looking. But can I talk to the women? Can I talk to the women who give men things to look at? Now, don't be like foolish. Don't be like, you know, you have nothing to talk about. You know what you have. Can I get a witness? And you know how to work what you have to get what you want. Are you with me? So just because you have big breasts, it doesn't mean that the whole world needs to see your big breasts. Why are you guys so quiet? I'm about to say you don't have a big breast. So whatever you have, that's big. Doesn't mean that you have. You see, here's what I'm trying to get at. If your brother has a weakness, if men have a challenge where they are turned on by what they see, don't you think, I'm not talking to any woman, don't you think Christian women, spiritual women, women who are being led by the Spirit, have a responsibility to their brothers in how they conduct themselves? As a woman, you need to conduct yourself in such a way that when men, or in this day and age, women even see you, they don't see you, but they see the glory of God. When you are walking with your high heels and tight clothes and exposed bodies, who are you advertising? Is this your new way of advertising God's glory? And if you are, what impact is it having? Now let's get back to the men. On Judgment Day, men, you can tell God, well, the reason why I am lost because of lust is because of the way the women were dressed. Every single man has a responsibility. You may not have control over how people dress, how they carry themselves, but you have control over how you respond. Amen. Now get this. It will be impossible for you to have a sanctified response to a woman who is scantily clothed if in your free time, you spend your free time looking at movies that glorify fornication and adultery. You spend your free time looking at pornography. You spend your free time talking about sexual escapades with your buddies. Guess what? Whatever you look at, whatever you listen to, whatever you speak, right, has a direct impact
on how you relate to what's around you. That's what made Joseph in our story this morning different from Solomon. Do you believe that if Joseph was spending his spare time looking at pornography and listening to music that glorifies sex, do you believe that when Potiphar's wife came into the room, he would have had the power to resist her? Do you think so? Absolutely not. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So God is saying here, let's move on quickly. Revelation 2 verse 15. Not only did they have the doctrine of Balaam, but they also had in verse 15 the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. The doctrine of who? The Nicolaitans. Now quickly, the doctrine of the Nicolaitans is pretty much the sister to the doctrine of Balaam. The doctrine of the Nicolaitans was a doctrine that promoted an irresponsible and reckless kind of faith. In other words, as long as you say you have faith in Jesus, you can live as you please. It was a kind of faith that did not permeate itself into the fiber, into the spiritual fiber and hearts of its adherents. It's a kind of faith that was only verbal but had no power. Are you with me? A kind of irresponsible faith. And God says he hates it. Let's come to a close now. This thing has too much in it about how to bring it to a close. But let's come to a close now. Revelation 2 verse 16. God says, repent. What does it mean to repent? To repent means to experience a turnaround, not a 360. Because with 360 you come back right where you were before. It's a 180. You go in like this, you turn around and you go in the opposite direction. Too many of us want to repent while we are going in the same direction. We are repenting, but we are still breaking the Sabbath. I'm repenting, but I'm still pursuing that illicit relationship. I'm repenting, but I'm still lying. No. Repenting is about going in a totally different direction. And that can only come through the regenerating power of the Holy Ghost. So God is saying in Revelation chapter 2 verse 16, repent, or I will come unto you and I will fight against them. Does that sound like Jesus? That sounds really violent. Jesus says, if you don't come, if you don't repent, I will come to you quickly and I will fight against you. Now if you stop there, you wouldn't quite understand what Jesus Christ means. Notice he says, I will fight against you with the word in my mouth. Lord have mercy, Jesus. What does that mean? What does that mean? Do we have 10 minutes to finish? 10 minutes? Can I take 10 minutes? Church, watch this. This is so powerful. Revelation 2:16. Christ is saying, if you don't repent, I will come to you quickly and I will fight against you with the word. What does that mean? What does it look like when God fights against you with the word in his mouth? Genesis chapter 32. Genesis 32. What does it look like when God fights against you with the word in his mouth? Genesis 32. Let's turn quickly. Genesis 32. Genesis 32. God is going to come and fight against us with the word in his mouth.
now. Genesis 32, verse 24 to 28. And Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled.
There what?
Wrestled a man with him until the breaking of day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, he touched the hollow of his thigh, and the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And he said, let me go, for the day breaketh. And he said, I will not let thee go except thou bless me. And he said unto him, what is thy name? A fight is taking place here between Jacob, his name means supplanter. His name means deceiver. Jacob, a man who has been led by his own carnal desires. Jacob is engaged in a fight with God. And Jacob is engaged in this fight with God, and day breaks, and the angel said, listen, it's time to call this quits. In other words, this struggle has been going on, and it's daybreak, and there is no submission, there is no deliverance, there is no victory. The angel says, let me go, but Jacob says, I will not let you go unless you bless me. In other words, as much as this fight is intense, as much as this fight has dislocated the hip of Jacob and caused Jacob physical pain, Jacob recognizes that there is always a blessing in the fight of God. Notice that Jacob says, Lord, I plead before you, go bless me. And God asks Jacob, what's your name? That's a rather strange question for God to ask. Or rather strange response from God to such a serious request for blessing. Why did God ask Jacob what his name was? You see, God is saying, before I can bless you, I need you to confess who you are. What is your name? My name is Jacob. Before I can bless you, I need you to confess who you are. Let's turn back to Revelation. Repent, or else I will come unto you, Revelation 2 verse 16, and fight against you with the sword of my mouth. Repentance has to do with confessing who we are and experiencing a transformation from who we are. And this blessing of repentance, this gift of repentance, is found in the fight. As God comes to us with the word in his mouth to fight against us, he's confronting us as intensely as he confronted Jacob. And it may mean that God may have to dislocate some hips and dislocate some shoulders and sprain some ankles and sprain some wrists. It may mean that God may have to allow us to face the consequences of our sins. It may mean that God may have to allow us to go through affliction, but there is a blessing in the struggle. Repent, or I will come unto you quickly and fight against you the sword of my mouth. He who have an ear. So in other words, I'm fighting against you the sword, meaning I'm confronting you with my word. The very word that you are compromising, the very word that you've turned your back on. I'm confronting you with my word. And if you have an ear, verse 17, hear what the Spirit is saying. Church, if we listen, we will hear the voice of the Holy Spirit in the midst of the struggle. in the midst of our affliction, in the midst of our pain. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit said unto the churches. To him that overcometh, Jacob overcame. Jacob overcame when he confessed who he was and he submitted to the sovereign power of God. That night, God changed his name from deceiver, from supplanter, to Israel. He who overcomes, I will give to eat of the word, the hidden manna. And I will give a white stone. What's a white stone? A white stone is a new character, a new lease of life. The Romans had an interesting practice in that when an individual was found guilty of a crime, that person was brought to court. And in the courtroom, they would have two stones. They would have a black stone and they would have a white stone. If the individual was acquitted, if the individual was set free, that individual was given a white stone, symbolizing that that individual is no longer under the condemnation of their past acts. That person has a new lease on life. If the individual was found guilty, they were given a black stone. God is saying, I will give you a white stone. And in that stone, a new name written in that stone, which no man knoweth saveth he that receiveth it. Church, this is God's message to every single one of us. I thank God that in the midst of our sin, in the midst of our mess, in the midst of our dysfunction, God faithfully pursues us. And God takes his time to confront us with his word. And sometimes a confrontation isn't pleasant. It isn't pleasant because we have fallen so deep into sin that sin has become the norm to us. And God, through his word, has to shake us and break us from the norm. God, through his word, has to disturb our peace in order to give us the peace that passes all understanding. Today, my question to us is, are we willing to experience the transforming power of God's word? Jesus is the one who has a sharp sword with two edges. Are we willing to experience that transforming power? If you want to experience God's transforming power through his word, please stand to your feet. God is engaging us in a fight. He's engaging us in a struggle. And even as he did with Jacob, he may dislocate some joints to get us back on track. But whatever it takes, let's allow God to do it. For it is better to be eternally saved with a physical infirmity than to have all the peace, to have all the possessions, to have all the security that this world could offer and be eternally lost. Heavenly Father, we thank you, dear God, for your word. We thank you, dear God, for this revelation of Jesus Christ, who is the one who has a sharp sword with two edges, representing the word of God. We recognize, dear Father, that in our own lives we have entertained the doctrine of Balaam, the doctrine, dear Father, that leads us into spiritual compromise for the purpose of economic and material expediency. And we have also entertained the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, an irresponsible kind of faith that professes belief in Christ but lives to please the lust of the flesh. Dear Father, we invite you to come and confront us with your word. Wrestle with us, fight with us if you must. Dislocate parts of us, dear Father, that lead us deeper into rebellion and bring us back on the right track. Bless us, dear God, with your hidden manna. Give us, dear God, a new name, a new character. Transform us from within, and may our lives begin to reflect your glory and your power, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.